everybody, and welcome to another Kerfuffle Showcase. And we have Blue Blood Royalty yet again here, the wonderful Jane Gardner, JP Gardner Associates. How are you, m'lady?
Oh, Simon, I'm all the better for seeing you. Obviously, made my week, my month. What can I say?
Beautiful. That's, and if it hadn't been for the fact that I know you've tripped over and hurt your leg, so just if anyone watching here, if Jane is grimacing, it's not down to my tortured inquiring interview style. It is genuinely the fact you're in pain, isn't it?
Oh, I'm in a lot of pain, but I've taken the painkillers, so hopefully I'll be fine.
Okay, well, that's good. If you start drifting off again, I'll alert your authorities. Jane, it's difficult to know how to start this, given that there is legend is overused within this industry. Obviously, just give, because this is about people here who may not know about your good self, could just give them a really brief overview of your history within the industry, and then I'll say how I knew about your business and everything else. Just give a bit of background.
Okay. We've got a couple of hours. Right. So I started in a state agency in 1986. I know it's impossible to think that. I was only two when I started. So I worked for Connells, that company that's still going strong today. Yeah. So I was with Connells for 6 years as I started as an estate agent. That was my journey, a great beginning. Then went out on my own and had my own agency, and literally that is kind of where I ended up in 2014, selling to Countrywide. So in that middle time, the agency Saul and Gardner did win lots of awards, so I kind of got to know you guys, got to know everybody from Kerfuffle and all the other lovely suppliers that are here. So that's it. But during that time, I started embracing social media into the business. I think I was one of the first estate agents in the country.
Yep,
it was about 2009, and I had my first Facebook page, built my own website, and started learning all things social, which was great for the agency. We did very well, and again, won awards for our social media. So once the business was sold, a lot of people came and said, can you help me with my business? Mm. And I took my sort of social media magic and I've transported that into other agencies. I do still do lettings. I'm an examiner for level 4 property mark. So, I keep my hand in and I do some consultancy work for lettings. But my main business and what we're talking about today is the digital marketing side of the business. And websites, we build websites, we run social campaigns, and we basically take on all of the marketing for agencies that's done online and offline as well, but just making sure that it's all tied in together. So I'm just thinking our pinks are a bit clashy. Sorry about that.
I don't think pinks can clash. I think it's an unclashable, unclashable colour. Look, I definitely think, just to reiterate, today is to talk about that, the digital side of things. It's how to use digital marketing effectively and win business from it. Always a nice one to do. Some do's and do nots to be aware of. Yep. I'm going to just jump in straight away just to say that, you're quite absolutely right, as we did meet each other, as it were, across the awards and trophy tables. And I kept here Saul and Gardner. And obviously I was amazed at what it was. A relatively small agency, wasn't it? You punched so far above your weight in terms of at those awards. And I was luckily enough, and one day, once I managed to blag my way onto the judging committees, and we did, and I think it was really you in your pomp, really at your height there. And it was about when you were, it was the people, it wasn't actually directly reviewing you guys, it was reviewing some of the staff. And out of about 12 people, from memory, it was about 3 or 4 of them were Saul and Gardner staff. And I remember that he wasn't a man to be easily impressed, Russell Manning of Manning Stainton, fantastic agent you'll know very well. But he reviewed a few of those and he just said, I don't know what she's doing down there. He wanted a change from opening an agency in Leeds to opening around you just to find out what the secret sauce was. My question is supposed to is, first of all, that we'll get into some of this, and this comes down to your natural knowledge of the industry. But do you think it was a natural sort of development for you to go into social, given that that empathetic nature you clearly had with the staff led itself as well into the social media side of things for marketing and agency?
100%. You know, I think, I did that talk at Lettings Live back when we had those and was explaining how Saul and Gardner was just the umbrella. It was all about the team, and it always is. It's always about the staff. You know, you can have a brilliant branch with one member of staff or of three members of staff or whatever it is, and then they leave and then it's gone. It's just the people. So right from the outset, we worked on the showcasing the individuals, making sure that people knew them as, you know, their own entity rather than it being a brand. So we were just, you know, a collection of really, really good people. And that is why there's such a beauty with social media and why so many people get it wrong. Because if you can use the power of social media, let's talk Facebook. What's in the name? I mean, people get it wrong all the time. Faces. Mm. Facebook is about faces. It is not, you know, it's not about house after house after house. It's about the people. So yes, you can showcase your properties, but do it with a person in there talking, showing it, becoming, you know, about that person. And you know, some of my clients now are smashing it with regards to getting their team on camera. They have their staff trained, and so many times you hear it, and I know that it's in the industry anyway. Oh, I don't want to be on camera. I don't want to be on camera. You've got to be these days. Okay. You know, that's where.
And by the way, Jane, I have heard that after I can't think how many hundreds of people I've spoken to on camera, and literally 90% of the time they'll say, "God, I hate going on camera." And here's the thing, agents. That's your job. You're brilliant at it. And I've genuinely never seen anyone clam up, you know, once you're able to relax them and get in front of it, because your job day in, day out is to talk to people. You are the, you know, you will always see an agent at a party. They're not the ones stood in the corner by themselves, are they? I think that's the reason why I chose estate agency, to be fair.
It's nobody likes to see themselves. I can remember the first few days when I was going on camera, you know, and we did it really early doors. You know, if you look back on like the Saul and Gardner YouTube channel, that, you know, way back a decade ago, we were out doing video after video after video, and everybody got used to being on camera, whether they liked it or not. We did training on it, and it made such a massive difference. And that, you know, you just can't, you don't want to look at yourself. Nobody does. All you do is you see your faults, you know, look at the way you are, but nobody else gives a shit. Nobody else cares. They really don't. No, you know, if somebody's talking to you face to face, they can see exactly what they see on camera just because you don't like it. You know, it's just the way it is. When you hear your voice on film, isn't it? You listen to yourself and you think, oh my God, does that my voice sound like that? Yes, it does. But that's just the way it is.
It's transformational, isn't it, Jane? Do you think that there's been us particularly as Brits? Because like the Americans famously, the Aussies, they've been out there doing this for a while. And that's because they've been able to marry, I think, much more effectively the brand of the business with the individual person's brand. It has taken a lot of, and I think a lot of that came down to business owners wanting to still keep it. And they haven't understood that you can have both, can't you? You can promote and present the people in your business without that being a headhunter's charter, and actually a lot of those people will thrive off that, and they're less likely to leave rather than what I think goes through the paranoia in some people's heads by pushing them out there. They're just going to put their head and their expectation levels too high.
Yeah, I mean, you always find that, and look, to be honest, there's always going to be business owners that are not going to embrace it, and it's as simple as that. And that's why I say that, you know, I will work with people who get it, who understand, you know, that they're doing it in the right way and they're doing it for the right reasons. It's, you know, there's too many people out there that think that they're going to put a post on Facebook and they're going to sell a house from it. You know, I mean, not a hope in hell. That is never going to happen. You know, you might get some interest the same way that you do on Rightmove. But if somebody's looking for a property, they're going to go to a portal. They're not going to go to your Facebook page. So go to your Facebook page to learn about your business and the people that are in it, and, you know, to become friends with it, so that when they actually need to sell a house, rent a house, buy a house, whatever, they feel like they know you, and they feel like, you know, that there's someone that's in their house already, because they're seeing you on their phone or on their computer or whatever. So it's, you know, it's a totally different platform.
So that makes perfect sense. So let's just go straight into that then. In terms of, so what sort of website should I have, Jane, as an estate agent today there, as you've seen it, sized it yourself? Don't compete with the portals in terms of, you know, finding the properties, because they've got everything. Why would you go somewhere else? So what approach do you advise your clients then on the sort of websites they should go for?
The first thing we always do is we look at who the audience is. So, you know, who are you trying to tempt by your website? You know, your website now is your shop window. So you think of the money that agencies spend on their shop window, doing their displays and their televisions and da 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 da. Nowadays, that money should be spent on a website. So when someone says, oh, you know, I want something cheap, a couple of grand, you know, okay, would you do that on your shop window firstly? Because you're going to have a lot more traffic coming past your website than you are coming past your shop window these days. So firstly, look at the people that you want to attract and talk to them. You know, they're not one size fits all. Oh, landlords, vendors. Okay, landlords, there's a million types of landlords, you know, and there's a million types of vendors. So let's look at who those people are. Look at your own database. I will say this, and agents just don't really know their own database. No. Where does your customer come from? Look over the last year, look at every sale that you've done, look at every let that you've done, and analyze those people. Where did they come from? Do they live locally? How do they know you? What's their lifestyle? You know, do they have pets? Do they follow a football team? You know, what really hone in, because you can use all that information now. You know, we know that digital is a big brother watching us. So, you know, the likes of Facebook, the likes of your website, the likes of Google, they know everything about you because they follow you every day that you're online. So the more information you know, the more you can tell these, you know, your platforms, your Googles, your social media platforms, the type of person you're looking for, and then it will find those people for you. It's all done for you. But if you don't know who your customer is, then how the hell are you going to explain that? So first and foremost, if you're thinking about going online or getting a new website, look at your database and really think about the person you're talking to, and then design everything for that person. You know, if it is that you deal with student lets, so you might have investor buyers that are looking for HMOs, then that's all the information you're going to have. If you're selling like a fine and country. So if you're selling to people who want a discreet, you know, they're maybe well-known people or whatever, then you've got to portray your vision in that way to attract the people that you want. What the most of the agencies that I work with, which was very much my niche as well, was just dealing with local people who wanted to know you. So therefore, let's talk to them in that way. Let's give them the information that they want. Make sure that they can find everything they want to about me. You know, have a real, our team pages on websites, and I'm sure any of your other website guys, Ben and all the rest of it, they will tell you the same. Team pages are always one of the top pages that people go to, because people,
it's amazing, want to know. Isn't it?
They want to know who they're dealing with.
Yeah. So you mentioned niche there. How niche should people go, Jane? Is, you know, I suffer from, as you've said many times when you stand there yawning at me, that I can turn a one sentence into War and Peace, because I have a paranoia of missing out saying what we do and everything else there.
Yep.
And I know you see this all the time on sites, don't you, that they're too heavy.
Mm.
Marketing talks about specialization and segmentation. How should people start? Should they understand that niche and stick to it? Or do you specialize once you've nailed that niche, then you move on from there?
I think everyone's at a different stage. And so, you know, it's going to depend on who you are and what you do. But once you know what you're great at, you know, surely you shouldn't be in business if you don't know what your USP is. You don't know what it is that makes people come to you.
But loads of people, I would argue there, Jane, I've sat in lots of rooms with business owners and they're asked that, you know, almost that elevator. And it's clear they don't know what their secret sauce is, their USP, isn't it? And this is, again, regardless of whether it's the website or otherwise, you need to get that and nail that quick, don't you?
You 100%. And, you know, I think the trouble is that nowadays there's so much stuff out there. There's such a lot of noise. And obviously that's what you guys do, is that you're helping people to make sense of the noise.
Yeah.
But quite often people don't really get it. And they're like, oh, I'll have a bit of this, or I'll have a bit of that, have a bit of the other. And then they've got all this mishmash of stuff. And actually, what are you doing with it? You're not, you know, half the time people don't even use most of it, and they're you know, oh, I've just got it because I needed to have that, or I've just got this because I need it. You know, sit down and think about it properly. Have a proper marketing. Estate agents are really bad at having marketing teams. You know, it seems as though, you know, we're sales people. We're not marketing people. Okay. What business do you know that doesn't have a marketing team? And it's always the estate agents. They're so behind with regards. Look, I'm talking about myself. I'm lumping myself in here as well. I mean, I'm lucky that I was a trained marketeer. That's what I did for my degree. So, you know, I had marketing background before I became an estate agent. So, you know, that's great. But if you don't understand marketing, then get somebody in your team who does.
Yeah.
And, you know, then you can plan it and you can say, what is it that we want to get out there? What's the message that we're pushing out? And then you start doing, your all of your campaigns based upon the different elements. And, you know, it's...
And do you think that, you mentioned there before in terms of the portals, do you think that over-reliance on the portals has taken away that kind of need to understand the marketing side of things? I mean, like, I've heard some people say before, which sounds ludicrous, you know, why do I need a website if I'm on the property portals? I mean, what would you say to that kind of approach?
I think that the portals will never, single out your business. So the portals are going to do, you know, unless you're going to pay them for, you know, your local home pages and your microsites and all the rest of it, that's all they're going to be interested in. So, you know, they want to have everything from everybody. You know, if you're sending people to Rightmove, then what are the chances that they're going to pick your agency? They might then, oh, look, there's another one here. Oh, that's a different agency. Oh, that's a, you know, so you're actually sending people to somewhere where they're going to see all of your competition. Yeah. Get them to your own website. And then you can capture them and you can, you know, showcase everything that you've got and why they should be dealing with you. I mean, we're really looking on our website to get the client base, aren't we? The website isn't there to sell a house, really. No. It's there to sell our business to the next person that's going to use our services. So, you know, it's got to look right. Quite a lot of agencies now don't even have like a search bar. They don't even have a property search on their website because they know that people are going to search property online, but it's all about the capture of why somebody should come to you. So you're talking about what I'm going to do differently. So yeah, if you want to rely on the portals, but you know, you're in the melee then, aren't you? You're in with everybody else. And if you don't stand out, well, you know, that's your problem, but you have it on your website. That's it, your niche. They're captured. And if you can keep them on the website, which is why we always have to work very carefully of the journey on somebody. You know, you don't want someone to just land on one page and then be off, unless it's a landing page, which is totally different to a normal page. You know, so if you're doing something for data capture or whatever, then that's a landing page. But if you're, you know, trying to keep someone on your blog, for instance, then once they've read one blog, you want them to, oh, how about this one? This one's of interest to you. And you want to make sure that flows, and you can look at your analytics and see that somebody stays on and then they go to the next page and the next page. But again,
Natural, as you said, natural flow. And one of your biggest problems is, Jane, and indeed the problem for many agencies, they know that the website is, if it isn't, you know, I would argue, obviously, given my old background, that CRM is just as important, but they are the two core pillars of prop tech, aren't they, really, in terms of your website and your CRM system going, should go hand in glove as well, clearly there. But one of the problems you've got there is because they know it's such a big big job, most important job and everything else, and they know that there is all this content then and everything else that goes on there, is do they have to write all the content on their website, or is that, you know, kind of the
I mean, you know, look, in most cases, yes, it is something that people forget about. Yeah. They buy this website and then they think, oh, why is it not all written for me? Okay. you know, when I'm building a website, I will write the content. Simple. If somebody wants me to, look, if they want to write their own content, that's fine. I'm there to help. But you have to write content in a specific way. Content is there for Google, really, or, you know, our search. Google is the biggest search engine, as we know. So, you know, with it, we write everything in a way that it's designed that Google will know exactly what it is that you do. Yeah. Where you do it and who you do it for, and that is very, very important. So that's what you would class as SEO.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't think about that. So our websites have an amazing SEO package on the back of them, and that's what we do. We make sure that every page that we post, whether it be a blog or whether it be a content page or whether it be a landing page or whatever it is written so that Google goes, I know exactly where you are, and that's going to go on organic search. It's going to be at the top of the rankings. And
well, that's the really important point there, isn't it, Jamie? So just when people hear SEO, a lot of people wrongly kind of think, oh, that's going to cost me. It's, you know, it's AdWords and it's paid for. What we're talking here is actually is the beautiful. So they might have, there are many reasons to not like these tech giants, but actually what Google does fantastically well is when it organically says this, that, you know, we have spidered that website. We know that this is what yeah. they do well. They will match that up to people, and that's where the magic happens, isn't it?
It's, yeah. it's providing because you find a lot of times, certainly from a content where, you know, writing, say, blog articles. So, you know, we write a lot of blog articles. They're very niche. They're very, you know, we research and we have an amazing blog platform that we work on, and it makes sure that every word that we put out there is unique content, and Google loves that.
Yeah.
What Google hates is when somebody's got an article, and I come across this quite often when I'm looking at agents and quoting for them. I might pick up one of their blog articles and put the first line into Google, and then I'm going to get 12, 13, 14 other articles exactly the same, except for the town is changed.
You're going to get penalized, yeah.
Google will just completely like go mad at that. It's not going to, it hates it. It's not even like it's a negative. It really is like, no, a no-go. I don't understand why people do that, and I don't understand why people sell that service, because I think unfortunately it's really bad for agents. And
yeah, it doesn't make sense.
You have to be unique. Google wants you to talk exactly the same way as we're talking about social media, about the people. It wants to see the people. It wants the life and soul. That's what it wants from its content. And everything you do in your business should be about the people and about your experience and what it is that you're great at, and why, not just, you know, sort of branded, you know, everything. Well, actually, in fairness, the branding is something that most social platforms don't like at all. So again, it's very difficult when you're a branded corporation, or if you're somebody that, you know, everything has to sit within that box. It's quite difficult to utilize it in a good way, because it's not really designed like that. It's not designed for uniqueness.
But blogs are important, aren't they? I mean, by definition, they are what, you know, again, is going to catch the eye of your audience. It's, Google's going to do that. So that is something, again, you once you get under the skin of those agencies that you work with, you can really support them on that side of things. Because I think we've all been there, haven't we? We've got very happy clappy about starting off our fantastic, exciting new newsletter or whatever it is. You start off the first month with, you've got 20 articles. Next month, you're down to 10, month 3, 5. And then after that, you're shouting around the office, who's got anything we can talk about? Keeping that consistency is one of the hardest things, isn't it, as an agent?
Yeah, it is. And what I always say to people is just, you know, jot down every time you're asked a question. If, you know, we pick up the phone, it's funny because I was doing some stats with one of my clients the other day on, you know, how many phone calls they've made in a month or they've received in a month through, you know, what was it, a pro or whatever it was. And, you know, it's thousands and thousands of phone calls, and agencies, that's what we do. We get people contacting us all the time. So every time somebody asks you a question, just jot it down, because one person's asked it. I bet there's loads of people out there that want to know. So these are the perfect blog articles to write. So, you know, I've just had a conversation today with someone and they asked me this question. This is what I said to them, and then we can look into it. And, you know, so if somebody gives me that question, I can write an article around it. I'll research it. I'll make sure that we know everything that there is to know about it. And that's great content. Because, you know, somebody's already asked you it, so therefore other people are going to want to know the answer to that same question. So, you know, it's just, you know, utilize everything that happens in the day and make something from it, rather than go, oh god, I've got no idea what to write about, oh da, da. Hang on, people have probably given you that content all day every day. So, you know, it's,
don't waste, you know, rather than seeing that as a challenge or an issue there, actually make hay with it, isn't it?
Yeah,
and,
absolutely.
And Jane, what would you go on to say then in terms of, you know, why should an agency use social media? I mean, we're way past the days where people used to say, well, will it ever deliver business? I mean, we just, it's so...
Nowadays, you can't not be on social media. Let's face it, everybody's on social media. And, on the other hand, don't just do it because you think you should be doing it. Do it because you understand it, or you know that it's going to help your business. Believe in it, because I can so remember when I started my first Facebook page, and one of the directors in my business said, it's never going to catch on. It's just, what the hell are you doing? What a waste of time and energy and everything. And, you know, here we are. Nearly 12 years later, and it's, you know, if you don't have social media, then you're missing out on business, because people will look for your social pages. They will, you know, regardless of anything else. They might not interact with it, they might not engage, you might never know, but I bet you that they've looked to see whether you're on social media. Because that's what we do now. We look and see what sort of thing is out there. Well, you know, what's the feel of that company? What are they about? And that's where you showcase that.
But being on, you know, social media can mean it is absolutely a spectrum, isn't it? So, you know, for example, what platform should people be using as an agency there? Are there some just golden rules, or does it all come down to the type of business you are?
Every platform has a completely different audience. So the one thing I would say is you never post the same thing on across all your platforms. I think
don't go into a Hootsuite and just copy it across all.
You know, it's not, you know, Twitter, we know, is a fast and furious platform where you have to have an opinion. So if I'm looking to find out what's happened today, I'll always just look on Twitter first. So, you know, if one of my systems is going slow, quick on Twitter, because that's the place that everybody goes, you know, and that. So, you know, that's probably the hardest platform to outsource to somebody else, because I can't have your opinion. I don't know your opinion on things. And also, I'm not going to sit as an outsourced agency all day long just waiting for comments to come up and be responding to them. So that is where I say it's an individual person. If you're on Twitter, you know, I've got some clients that love using Twitter, and that's fine. I will post something and I will tag them in it, and that's fine. They will then go on and have the discussion about it, no problem. LinkedIn, you know, is a very, very good place to find business. So when I was working as an agency, I had, I did some training on LinkedIn, actually, with the whole team. So to make sure that everybody had really good LinkedIn profiles, were connecting with the right people. If somebody rang up and said, I'd like you to come and value my property, the first thing I would do would be look them up on LinkedIn and connect with them. Yeah. I've got then a connection before I've even met them. So, you know, they can see my history, they can see all of my experience. I can know a little bit more about them. So when I go to see them at the property, you know, I'm in with a little bit more of a chance now, because they've kind of like looked me up and I've looked them up, and we feel like we've got a connection. And even if I don't get the business, I can still connect with them and find out what's going on. So, you know, that it's very good from that point of view. It's not really the sort of place, again, where you're going to post your properties. You know, you can put some reviews on, you can talk about your team, you know, anything that's happened from you know, good things that you do with your colleagues and out and about, because that's going to encourage other people to look and want to work for you. So it's a very good place to find great employment opportunities. But it, you know, Facebook has got to be the place where you are just posting faces. So, you know, just get out of your head that you're putting property after property on Facebook. Facebook is faces. So that's where your team and what you're doing and what fun you're having or being out and about, the day in the life, you know, all of those things, fabulous, really, really great content, and they will definitely get you noticed. You definitely notice that people, when you're out and about in town, oh, I've seen you on Facebook. Yeah. You know, I know you from Facebook. They feel like they know you. So
how important is it to mobilise your own clients to sharing information as well? Is that a skill in itself?
Yeah, and this is, you know, it is a big problem. There's some reason why people, when they're taking applicants' details or they're doing a deal and they're getting information, I don't know why those frontline staff don't say, and we're on social media, you know, why don't you follow us on social media? We can give discounts. I mean, I don't know if you remember back my agency, we had a reward card scheme. So we had every business locally on our reward card scheme. It was a lot of work. And I know that I've got some other clients that talked about having these schemes. And I just say, just don't underestimate how much work you will need a full-time person running it, because you can do a lot of damage if it's not run properly, you know. So if you're giving out a reward card and then someone goes to use it and they go, never heard of it, you know, that's not going to be great.
That sort of stuff can really become a referral engine, can't it? You've spoken about the negative there, but actually it only takes a couple of those. That's absolutely fantastic. They're great guys there. That pay it forwards ethos really does.
When you work it good, you know, so I've got one client at the moment that has the reward card and we're constantly tagging each other. We always are promoting their businesses. If they're doing something, they promote us back. You know, opened up the whole communication in the area by having that. So great, but don't think it's an easy job. Oh, you know, I can just buy that package. I think someone does a package where, you know, you get discounts of sort of nationwide. It's not the same. You want to have local businesses and promote other local businesses. And especially those other businesses are probably on Facebook or on social media as well, and they want help. So, you know, great. You can get that, you know, really good feel going. And then obviously Instagram has been a photo sharing platform. It is changing. And again, you know, this is one of the, I guess, the downsides of social media is the algorithms change a lot.
You can't
just go, okay, that's what I'm doing and leave it at that. You know, you have to keep up to date with it. We do that. That's our job. So when it's outsourced to us, we know what to change. But, you know, Instagram has a very big place in social media and getting bigger.
It's growing and growing, isn't it? I mean, it's not quite
growing enormously. And the reels and the, you know, your 30 second reels taking on the sort of TikTok platform, and then your IGTV, you know, Instagram is massively pushing video content. So fabulous if you've got walkthroughs, speed them up. You know, have a bit of fun with it. You know, that is, you get thousands of views on your reels. So,
and Jane, just in terms of obviously everyone's here to build their following as well. Do they come to, is building the audience a byproduct of just doing all this interesting and exciting content that you should be doing anyway? Or do people come to you with actually defined goals and say, I want to get to X thousand number followers? Or is that the wrong drive?
It's the wrong way to do it, because it's about the engagement from those followers. And I always say, you know, firstly, if you're if your business is in a village, how many people are in that village? So look at, you know, most areas now have a group on Facebook where the local people, you know, will get together and chat. So you know, I live in Chorley Wood and our local group here has 16,000 people. So, you know, potentially 16,000 people is my audience, because they're all the people that live around here. If I'm an estate agent here, then I would say that's my 16,000 people. So if I can be in with that group, if I can be, you know, speaking to that group and giving them really good data. I'm not there to sell to them. I'm not there to go, oh, you know, come to my, you know, but I'm going to give information away, then I've got that audience. If you're in a massive town, then, you know, you've got, you're going to get more following. So, you know, the following will come when you're giving the right.
Don't rush it, basically. Don't try and push it.
You know, it's one of my clients has got a landlord group. So within their Facebook page, they have a specialized landlord group. And, you know, it's just got their landlords on. So it's a, you know, again, a complete and utter like closed audience full of the right people, you know. So whereas on your normal page, you might have people that are never going to buy or sell a house.
Yeah.
But you might have some that might do it in 6 months. You might have some that did it before. And now, you know, so that audience isn't there to look at a property and a property and a property. You know, they're going to go, oh, unless they're beautiful houses and, you know, everyone's a bit nosy, but they're not, you know.
But what you've got there is you've got the classic trade-off, haven't you? You've got lots of numbers there, but with low engagement, or the more specialised you get, of course, is you might have much lower numbers there, but they are highly engaged and they're going to see you as the thought leader, which ultimately, of course, is where you're after. And just in terms of that then, Jane, so if we talk about, obviously, again, probably one of the wrong stats in terms of the vanity stats that we talk about, followers and everything else, how do you ultimately then migrate and move those to, you know, all this social engagement into actual business leads for your company?
It's probably one of the hardest things to do, because I don't think people would come and do business with you and necessarily say, I'm doing business with you because I've seen you on Facebook.
Yeah.
I don't, you know, you might now and again, but, you know, it's not from your news feed we're talking, not from ads. That's a totally different thing. So this is just from your, you know, again, your company profile, you know, where you're talking about things. And again, one of the issues is that the staff sitting at the front desk that are taking those details from somebody, I bet they're not asking, have you seen our Facebook page? And that is a problem. There's a gadget that you can get called, I think it's called Swirl or something like that. And it's got the numbers. So
I love them. I have got one myself.
In an office, I always say to people, get one and put it in the office, because there's nothing better than seeing that tick up. And it does encourage the people sitting at the desk to say, why don't you like our Facebook page? And then we can watch that go up.
I think it's a brilliant one, Jane. I'll post it at the end. I'm pretty sure you're right. It is Swirl. It's a French company.
Yeah.
And I think that being able to link that, you know, you always see them, you know, with baristas and things like that. Being able to see that and link that into it is it's a tangible connection, isn't it?
Because if you're not asking, you're not going to get, you know, it's as simple as that. So you've got to encourage your team to be part of it. When I do all of my social clients, we have a WhatsApp group and we're always in touch. I always say, get everybody on it. You know, we have like loads of people. We'll have a bit of banter. I feel like then that they know I'm here. I'm, you know, so if something happens in the day, something good, or they're out and about, I just encourage them to send me as much information as you can. And I will use that how I see fit to use it. But you know, it's, if you're not doing that and you're just, there's somebody in the background just doing the social media and they're not, there's no connection with that front line, it's just never going to work.
And talking about that connection, Jane, should you allow one of your negotiators to run the account for you in a business, or, you know, or is
it's
that
very difficult?
I don't know what's...
It's kind of like a, you know, it is a big job. I know people think, oh, you're just posting on Facebook. You know, you're not just posting on Facebook. You're making sure that that content looks great, and that it's going out at the right time and it's got the right information on it. So if you're expecting somebody whose job is to sell property or to rent property to also be doing your social media, you know, what's going to take precedence? You know, suddenly they're busy and then their clients are coming in and da-da-da, then the social media's gone out the window. And the consistency and just constantly being there and doing posting and answering questions and having, you know, I have now, Facebook loves you to have a WhatsApp messenger. So, you know, people are on contacting you all the time on social media.
Yeah.
You can't expect, so have somebody that's dedicated to it. And yes, you know, you might say a young person, but have they got the experience to talk to that person? You know, I've taken over accounts where they've had somebody in-house, and actually that hasn't worked out because that person hasn't been able to deal with you know, conversations on social media and handle it correctly. And I can, and you know, my team can. We know what to do and what to say and how to, you know, I would say complaints are great because there are opportunities to, you know, really turn something around. So, you know, but again, it's a training thing. And so normally it's better to have it, you know, have somebody that knows what they're doing. So I wouldn't say it's necessarily a youngster's thing. there's more older people on Facebook than there are youngsters. So, you know, it's, I think that
leads us perfectly into the specialisation thing. And again, that what you're able to do there, Jane, is you've got two, let's be honest, you've got a number of, you can do it all yourself. And there's nothing wrong with that. But in terms of understanding what the time and energy dedicated, you do need to set aside that time because otherwise nothing's going to be happening. Secondly, you can just use a social media, marketing agency or something like that. Now, the big problem with that is that you aren't, you know, again, it'll take ages for them to get you. They don't understand property. You keep going back. I think you're the top rated, you have the top rating qualifications at Arla. You talk to a normal marketing agency and they're going to think Arla is the milk board, isn't it? Mm. That's what it strikes me as. Again, ignore the local guy, ignore the person who's a specialist outside of, there's a lot you can learn from those people, but unless you want to spend what will seem like a lifetime educating them on what property is about, and who has the time for that? That's where I see you've got a real niche here, Jane.
Yeah, no, I mean, my heart and soul goes into everything I do, and my team know that. So, you know, I do oversee everything. Clearly, I can't, you know, handle every single account. So everybody has an account manager, but we discuss everything. I'm here for expert advice. You know, I can talk about what the best downloads would be, and I can make those downloads for you, and I can put it onto your website, and I can do everything. So, you know, you don't have to worry about it. You don't have to give any sort of massive direction to your agency. I can deal with all of that because I know how to, and I know what to say, and, you know, all the sort of legislation that goes with the state agency.
And that's so invaluable. Yeah. You've been really kind enough, haven't you? You said for Kerfuffle members, you'll actually give them a health check where you'll sit down, go through them as well, talk about what they're doing, try and understand. And it is, you need to understand both sides as well. I know, Jane, you probably won't say this, but it's really important you get a feel for the company as well, isn't it? Because as you do, when you throw, you're all about passion and everything else there. And to be able to have that passion there, you need to be able to connect, don't you?
Yeah, I need to be part of the team, firstly. I'm not an outsourced person that you don't see. I have to be part of it because I need to know what the vision is, what your drive is, where your business is going, what you want from it. And I have to understand that, and I have to sort of be bought into it as well. So, you know, I work with the people who want to do it right, and want an expert to help them. I'm not the sort of person that can just post, you know, I look at it and I wouldn't do that. I don't think there's any point. I think you're better off not bothering, personally, or make it about your brand and your people and your whole, you know, being. Put that out there, and, you know, you've got this massive, massive platform where you can really showcase your niche. And if you're not prepared to do it, then don't bother at all.
No, exactly. Well, look, that's a perfect time. I mean, go first of all, you know, have that session with Jane, as ever. Always go to the landing pages, go see JP Gardner and Associates, see the reviews there, see the reviews that are some of the very best people in the industry. And as I said, if this is on your agenda, if you're not doing it at all, there's your first one. If you're not doing it right there, you suspect you're not doing it. Take some of Jane's time, which she's been kind enough to do there, and I'm absolutely convinced you will get, you know, far, far more out of it than you would ever expected.
Look forward to it. Yeah.
Jane, thank absolutely. You once again. It would be great to catch up with some of you and your clients, and we're going to drill into some more individual issues over the coming weeks and months, aren't we?
Definitely. I'm here whenever, so lovely to see you.
Well, good luck with the leg, and we will catch up soon. Cheerio. Bye-bye.
Bye.